Thank you. It is so good to have you join with us again at the same time each week. And again, we do count it our privilege to have you follow along in our Bible studies. We're in this tremendous book, the Book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible. And we're continuing now in our Bible studies as we have just finished up here in chapter 5. Or I should say, we've not taken every verse, but we have hit the highlights of it. And chapter 5 shows the redemption, or no one in heaven, no one under the earth, no one in the earth is able to open the book here, or the scroll, which unleashes all of the things yet to happen in Bible prophecy. We come over here to chapter 6 now, and we had found the Lord Jesus was the only one. He is the Lamb of God. He took the scroll. He is the only one worthy in order to pronounce judgment upon this earth. He is the judge of all of the earth. And then he came forward, took that scroll, and opened it up, and now we're ready to proceed here on the things that are yet to come upon this earth. Now we come over here to chapter 6, and we begin to see here the unleashing of some of the judgments of God upon the earth. And I might say this to the outset, chapter 6, when we unfold the seven seals here, are just the down payment of the intensified judgments of God as we proceed on to chapters 8 and 9 and then clear on through the book of Revelation. So chapter 6 is the unveiling here of what's going to take place and who is going to do it. Now, with your Bibles in hand, we hope that you'll go with us here and follow along here, and you'll begin to understand here as we're in this tribulation period. We're in the time now when the church has been raptured, but that hasn't happened on this earth yet. When Christ shall descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, the trump of God shall sound, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and us which alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the clouds, so shall we ever be with the Lord. So, when that takes place, that triggers the seven-year tribulation period, and then at the end of that, Christ comes back and sets the kingdom up. So everything from chapter 4 on in the book of Revelation transpires in this tremendous book here of the book of Revelation and transpires during that seven-year tribulation period. Also parallel to that, Daniel also speaks of that same period of tribulation time of 7 years. Also, keep this in mind, Matthew chapter 24, the whole chapter is dealing with this seven-year tribulation period and what will take place during that particular period of time. So we're going to be referring back to the book of Matthew along with chapter 6 here to show how these things parallel with Matthew chapter 24 and the fulfillment here after the church or the body of Christ is raptured out. I'd like for you to go with me now, Revelation chapter 6, and let's begin here in verse 1. And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the voice or the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, come and see. And we're finding here, he says, come up here, John. I want you to come here. Remember now here what we had studied here concerning the four beasts. These are heavenly beasts now. And these are part of the train in heaven. Things that we would know nothing about if John hadn't revealed them here and the Lord revealed them to him. Now we come on here to verse 2 because we're going to find in verse 2 here, we have what seems to be a parallel between the white horse here in Revelation 6 and the white horse in Revelation chapter 19. But when we examine it very closely, we're going to find out they're not parallel at all, but they are diametrically opposed. The white horse here in verse 2, and let's read it. And I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. So there's some things we want to look at here. First of all, he had a bow, but he had no arrows. In order to be offensively and on the aggressiveness here with power, we find out at first he has a bow, but he has no arrows. So that's going to show us something, and we're going to give you some parallel chapters to this to show that he comes in peaceably. This is the Antichrist riding a white horse. When you go to the book of Revelation, as we're going to progress and get back there, in Revelation 19, the one riding the white horse is the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, why in the world do you say that the white horse here in Revelation chapter 6, why is Satan riding a white horse? And the answer is very simple. Satan always likes to duplicate the Lord Jesus Christ. He's always wanted to be king of this earth. And we're going to see in Matthew chapter 4. Remember when he offered Christ all of the things of the earth? What a joke that was. And Christ said, you know, I don't fall down and worship anyone. Here it is, the Lord Jesus Christ, King of kings, Lord of lords. And we have this fool, Satan, actually trying to offer the Lord the kingdoms here upon the earth. They already belong to the Lord. Yet Satan is so even deceived himself. So we find out Satan is always an imitator of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he imitates, for example, he imitates salvation. The Lord Jesus Christ said, he said concerning salvation, that all you have to do is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. You know what Satan's ambassadors say? Let me give it to you. It's a counterfeit, but it looks religious. A counterfeit is something that looks so close to the original that you can hardly tell the difference. Religion is doing something to merit eternal life. Salvation is not doing anything to merit eternal life, but going to heaven by faith in the one who gave his life to buy your right to have eternal life. We go to heaven on the merits of Jesus Christ, not our own merits. And that's what the Bible teaches. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. Satan comes in and says, no, your water baptism will take you to heaven. Now, you be a good person and you can go to heaven. And yet the Word of God refutes that in Isaiah 64:6. All of our good works are nothing but a pile of filthy rags. And he says, you're not saved by the water, you're saved by the blood, in whom we have redemption through his blood, Ephesians 1:7 says. Titus 3:5 says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he has saved us. Mercy means withholding judgment that we deserve. So therefore, he sent the judgment upon Christ on Calvary to withhold our judgment. When we put our faith in Christ, we're passed from death unto life, and death is the judgment we deserve, which is eternal separation from God. Satan always comes in as a counterfeit. Here he's going to come in as a counterfeit, and he's going to come peaceably. He's going to present himself as the great peacemaker now, and he's going to deceive practically the whole world. Not all of the world, but the majority of the world. Now, with that in mind, let's go back here to the book of Daniel. Let's go back to the book of Daniel, and you're going to see back here that in the book of Daniel, where Daniel speaks about this Antichrist also. And when he speaks of him, I'd like for you to go with me now back here to Daniel chapter 8 here in verse 25. Notice what he says. And through his policy also he shall cause craft to prosper in his hand, and he shall magnify himself in his heart, and by peace he shall destroy many. You can have a false peace of religion. We have people say, well, you know, you've been baptized, you've been placed into the body of Christ. No, for by one Spirit have we all been baptized, we're placed into the body of Christ. That is spiritual baptism, you see. Being baptized never saves anyone. And let me say this, we have some today that say, you know, bring your babies and have your babies baptized. Let me say something to you. Probably one of the most damnable teachings you'll ever find, and it's contrary, diametrically opposed to the Word of God, and nowhere do you ever find in the Word of God where you are ever to baptize babies. It is not so. It is a religious practice that has been indoctrinated by men instead of taking what the Word of God says. In Luke chapter 18, when they brought the infants to Christ, he said, for such is the kingdom of heaven. What happens with that is this. You falsely lead the parents to believe that your baby is all right if we come and have him sprinkled or we have that little baby baptized. Most all babies that some churches that practice that do the sprinkling because they're not going to put a little baby under water. Another false teaching that we're going to find is very simply, and this is the Antichrist loves to deceive you by religion, not Christianity. Religion is always you doing something to merit eternal life. So you're going to bring your baby and you're going to have that baby baptized, and that's going to merit your baby eternal life. How ludicrous that is. Diametrically opposed to the Word of God. You just can't find it in the Bible. Next time some minister wants to do that, say, show that to me in the Bible. He cannot do it. It's not there. You'll embarrass him. He'll try to talk around it, but it's not there. But here's the damnable part of that. That mother and dad are deceived by thinking something they did is going to get that baby to heaven. What they fail to realize is, in believing the word of God, when that baby reaches the age of accountability to know right from wrong, and that varies within the child, that child has to make a decision whether to accept or reject Jesus Christ. But being under what that pastor or that church has told them, well, your baby is under the grace of God now, and therefore it's going to be all right, and that grace is going to be passed on to that baby. That's a lie out of the pits of hell. That is not so. Every one of us shall give an account of ourselves to the Lord. That little baby grows up, mother and dad, when he gets to be a young person, says, well, we had you baptized when you were 3 months old or a month old or so forth. That child is then deceived by the parents who were deceived by the preacher who was deceived by the church. And then you try to lead that person to Christ and say, you know, your baptism when you were a child does not take you to heaven. Nowhere are you commanded anywhere in the Word of God to have babies baptized. And then I try to lead that person, or another minister tries to, or another Christian says, no, that isn't true. You have to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ for yourself. And that person will soak in what mother and daddy did for them when they were a child and will not accept Jesus Christ and trust in their infant baptism to take them right straight to hell. Now, that's the teaching of the Word of God. Now, that's contrary. Satan loves that. And he just loves for you to feel religious. He loves for you to feel like everything is all right now. You'll never merit eternal life by water baptism, by good works, by church membership, by giving to the community or giving to the church. You find out it is not by works of righteousness which we've done. But Satan is a deceiver. Here he's going to deceive the world and say, I'm coming in peaceably. Now go on over with me here to Daniel. Daniel speaks about this again and does it again. In chapter 11, let's notice here in verse 21 and 24. In Daniel chapter 11 and verse 21, he says here, and in his estate, that's the Antichrist, shall stand up a vile person, that's old Satan, to whom they shall not give the honor of the kingdom, but he shall come in peaceably and obtain the kingdom by flatteries. Flatteries. It doesn't matter how nice the person is that feeds you false doctrine. He'll just give you cyanide and send you right straight to hell, kill you with spiritual death, because you're trusting in something you do instead of what Christ did for you. Notice in verse 24, and he shall enter peaceably, even upon the fattest places of the providence. This goes right in line. And we find out also as we come over here. I'd like for you to notice here, while we're here, let's go over here to Matthew. Let's go to Matthew here and go here to chapter 4, Matthew chapter 4, all right, while we're over here. Oh, Satan loves to do this. He loves to tell you and he loves to say to you, you know, you can have this, you can have that. You'll think it's Christ because it comes through a church. But if it's not by grace or you saved through faith and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So when we say, as a Christian, opposed to religion, religion is always you doing something to merit eternal life with God. Christianity is receiving the merits of Jesus Christ on the cross, who was the high priest, who was sinless, to go to that cross and pay for my sin, and offers me eternal life freely and absolutely by faith plus nothing. Now we come here to verse 4, or chapter 4 here in verse 9. And he said unto him, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. That's what old Satan wants. Go with me now over here to Matthew chapter 24. And as we've said, this parallels Revelation here in chapter 6, because they're both speaking about this tribulation period. So we're over here to Matthew chapter 24. Notice in verse 5, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And you know what? I just want to bring this out. Whenever you have a preacher, and we keep emphasizing this, because there's so many people deceived by this, you get in a certain area, and you'll find a certain group of churches that propagate that. But you get in other areas where you're down around the Bible Belt, and you have Bible-teaching churches. They just laugh at that kind of foolishness and wonder how anybody can act absolutely swallow that kind of thing, thinking that a preacher can forgive your sins. All through the Bible, it is God who is the forgiver of sins. But Satan loves for you to go to that preacher and confess your sins, and you actually think this man can forgive your sins. All of this is nothing but the working of Satan as he comes peaceably. He loves you, and he wants the best for you, and he's God's intercessor for you. But we find the Bible teaches that there is one God, one mediator between God and man, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. Never a preacher. You'll never find a preacher. God gave that power to be the intercessor between you and God. The Lord says in Hebrews chapter 4, come boldly before the throne of grace. It doesn't say come boldly before the preacher, does it? It says boldly before the throne of grace. We have forgiveness of sins in Christ, not a human being. And I wonder if that preacher can forgive your sins, he ought to be able to forgive his own. And if he can forgive his own, then he must be Christ. But this is the kind of false teaching that comes in today. Wherever a preacher says, I'll forgive your sins, you have a spirit of Antichrist, you have a false teacher, and you have a false Christ, even though he'll say, no, 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 I'm doing this for Christ. No, he has placed himself as Christ in your eyes. If he really, really loved Christ, he would point you to the Lord Jesus Christ and never to himself, never under any circumstances. That's how you tell a true church from a false church. But you get around other areas where you have Bible-believing churches, and they just laugh at that kind of phony baloney, you see. But you get in certain areas where you do not have many Bible-believing churches, then it seems like some shockwave going through the air. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Now, we come over here, again, here to Matthew chapter 24. I'd like for you to notice here, if you will, in verse 5, again, to many. We'll read it one more time. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. This is the profit of reading your Bible for yourself. And sad, if you go to church and you don't carry your Bible, you are the top-notch candidate to be deceived by false teaching, because you never read your Bible. You're trusting that preacher. You're trusting that church. God wants you to trust him. He wants you to trust his word in order to check out to see who is the true and who is the false, you see. Let's go back to Revelation chapter 6. So he comes peaceably here. And you know, sometimes you'll meet some of these preachers and you'll think sugar wouldn't melt in their mouth, and they're feeding you nothing but poison through the pulpit, you see. Let's go on down and see what happens now when we get to the next seal. Let's go here to verse 4, all right? Error, verse 3, and when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereupon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. Now, I'd like for you to underline your Bible, kill one another, because we're going to show you where cannibalism had taken place even in the nation of Israel, and it will yet take place during the tribulation period. They shall kill one another. Why is that? We're going to find here as we go on down, there's going to be such a famine on this earth as it was in the days of Israel before the captivity. They actually killed human beings and ate them because there was nothing to eat. That's happened, and it's going to happen again. There is a famine coming, but underlying kill one another, and there was given unto him a great sword. And this is what the Antichrist is going to do. You'll find out that red is always associated here with terror and death. In Revelation 12:3, we have the red dragon. That's old Satan. We have in Revelation 17:3, we have the red beast. That is, again, old Satan. So it's always associated with terror and with death. Now let's go on down to the fifth seal here and get this. But while we're here, right before we go, on the red seal, go back with Matthew chapter 24 and verse 6 and 7 and get the parallel for this. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, and see that you be not troubled, for all of these things must come to pass, but the end's not yet. We come over here in verse 6, for nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be, boy, get this, famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places. The word divers in the Greek means different places, various places. Now let's go on back. We come here to verse number 5. As we're going to get down here in the next week or so and tie all of these together, we're going to tie in the verses here on cannibalism. This will shock you. And I never knew such things existed. I never knew when I would read the Old Testament where God said about a human being having a sexual relationship with an animal. That was hard for me to ever conceive until I was on the police department for a number of years and happened to walk in a house on a call that we had had and actually seen that in practice. It was the most gross, it was the most despicable thing I've ever seen in my life. And it was one of a woman that I think if she ever got married, she'd have got married to Satan. She was the dirtiest and filthiest woman I have ever seen in my life and have ever seen since. But we'd had many dealings with her. But this is how low man can go. Now, when it comes to you dying or eating another human being, but we're going to see what these plagues bring here, and we're going to see what Satan does. You've got to remember something. And I'd like for you, hold your place here, right before we continue on, I'd like for you to go back with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 8, in verse 44, because Satan is a deceiver. But one thing about it is, and God tells us about him, he is a murderer and he is a liar. I'd like for you to notice in verse 44 of John here, chapter 8. And he's talking to these scribes and Pharisees, and he says, "You are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do." Now, these are religious leaders now. These are not the down-and-outers now. These are the ones that were held in high esteem by the people. These were your scribes, your Pharisees, your interpreters of the law, your ones that would write the commentaries and so forth. These were the ones representing God, supposedly, but they were false leaders. And he said, "You are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do." He was a murderer from the beginning. I'd underline murderer because there's two things characteristic about old Scratch here. He's a murderer and he's a liar. He was a murderer from the beginning and he abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. And when he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar. I'd underline that. Two characteristics about Satan. He's a murderer and he is a liar and the father of it. And he goes on down in verse 47. "He that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God." Now let me ask you something. Are you one that's laughing at the book of Revelation? Do you think these things aren't going to come to pass? Well then, if you don't, that's because you're not of God. You're not saved. You're not trusting the Word of God. You don't believe the Bible really is God's inerrant Word given to mankind. You don't believe that. You believe it's just like some of your modern philosophers, and this includes many of your modernistic preachers, all of your modernistic preachers, except your Bible teaching pastors who believe the Word of God, that it is true. Every word of it is true. But you find these here, and let me ask you, if you're listening, you think this isn't going to come to pass? Let me ask you something. If you study your Bible, you'll find out everything God has said in the past has come to pass. You're going to find out that everything he's predicted for the future is going to come to pass. But if you don't believe that, you know why? You're lost. You're a child of Satan. You're a child of the devil. You're dead in your trespasses and sins. You have no faith in anything but humanistic philosophy. You have no faith in anything but yourself to get out of this world, whatever you can get for it. You have no faith in Jesus Christ. You probably doubt where you even come from. You doubt creation. You doubt anything about the Bible. And yet you may go to church every Sunday. You may pray to church because that is a social status that makes you acceptable in the community, and you have fooled everybody that you're such a nice individual. When in reality, God says the heart is desperately wicked and deceitful, and who can know it? God knows your heart. That's why he's called you. No matter how much you dress yourself up and pray to church on Sunday morning, he knows every wicked thing you've done behind somebody's back. He knows every sin that you committed that you have covered up. He knows everything about you. He knows every thought you're thinking. He knows every motive that you have for doing what you're doing, with maybe an ulterior motive to only bring about your advantage in whatever you do. God knows all of that. That's why he says you're a sinner. That's why he says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, you see. But then we continue on here now, and we find out here, we're coming on here to the black horse. "And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, 'Come and see.' And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, a black horse. And he that sat upon him had a pair of balances in his hands." Now we're going to see where the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. Oh, Satan is a liar, isn't he? You know what? He can tell you that you can do anything you want to do. Lost people are going to love this Antichrist, because you know why? They can waller in their sin and it's going to be legal. It's all right. It's acceptable. You know, we're getting that today because we're so close to the very tribulation period, the next event's the great event, the Messiah comes again, that, you know, it's socially acceptable now to do many of the sins, even commit first-degree murder with abortion. That is acceptable now because we have a Supreme Court of idiots that care nothing for human life and therefore care nothing for morals and anything like that. So therefore, go out and kill your children. I thank God there are some leaders rising up in these days that are opposing that. They probably won't get elected in the national election, but at least there are some that's saying we've made a mistake. Instead, if we're going to kill anybody, let me say this. Mothers, you're the one that got yourself pregnant. You're the one that now wants to kill your child. Let me ask you, why don't we let the child live and kill you so you can't go out and do it again and kill another child? If anyone's going to die, mother, why not you? You're the one that's the immoral one. Your poor child didn't do anything but innocently be conceived. By your immorality, let's give the child a chance. Maybe he'll have better morals than you do. So if we really wanted to be rightful, we would kill the mother who intends to kill the child, let you and I in society step in and save the child and kill the mother so she can't go out and have another illegitimate child and plan to kill that one too. I wonder if that would be justice or would that be too gross? So let's just kill the baby, enjoy sin for a season, and hang it up. Well, we're in that time. Well, I see our time's going. We'll have to continue on next week. It'll be very interesting. Hope you'll follow along. If you've never taken time to write, we hope you'll do that. First of all, we'd like for you to trust the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior to know that you have a home in heaven. If you've never written, our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at the same time, may the Lord richly bless you as we ever pray, even so come, Lord Jesus.